We will just start the service like we do on Wednesday. Take a songbook and let's sing together, shall we? Turn over, if you will, to 136. 136, there's a song in the air, there's a star in the sky. 136, let's stand together to sing it. 136, Brother Bob.
There's a song in the air, there's a star in the sky, there's a mother's deep prayer, and a baby's low cry, and the star ranges far while the beautiful sing for the manger of Bethlehem cradles a king. There's a tumult of joy o'er the wonderful birth, for the virgin sweet boy is the Lord of the earth. By the star ranges far, while the beautiful sing for the manger of Bethlehem cradles a king. On that last, we rejoice in the light, and we echo the song that comes down through the night from the heavenly throng. I will shout to the lovely angel they bring, and we greet in his cradle our Savior and King.
All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this evening, and thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to gather together here, and for each one that's made their way here to our service this afternoon, early evening. And Lord, I pray that you'd meet with us, you'd give us what we need tonight in this service. Help us to focus on the songs we sing and the fellowship together, and Lord, most importantly, upon your word when we open it in a little bit, and that you'll speak and minister to each of our hearts. Give us what we need on this Christmas night. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Let's look over at the page, just page right across the way there, 135, 135, hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king. On that first, hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled, joyful. Desire of nations come, fix in us thy humble home. Rise, a woman's conquering seed, bruise in us the serpent's head. Adam's likeness now we face, stamp thine image in its place. From above, in thy love, hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king.
All right. Now we're going to have give some announcements, and then we're going to take a time tonight to have share a few testimonies, all right? So you want to say something good about the Lord and brag on God, this may be your last chance in this year to do that. So get something ready. We'll have the guys take the microphone so everybody can hear, and those who might be watching live stream will be able to hear the testimonies as well. So remember, Wednesday night for the midweek service, John and Emily will be here with us, and they'll be updating us on what took place in Uganda while they were there, and the things they learned, and what the Lord did in the last 9-10 months they were there. And then what they'll be doing is they're planning on about a year, I think, of deputation, raising additional support, and then heading to the Congo and what that'll mean for them. And so they'll be singing for us and presenting and doing the preaching and such Wednesday night. It'll be a good service together. So that'll be the midweek service Wednesday at 7. And then remember, next Sunday is 9:30 and 10:30 and 5:30. And 5:30, same time as tonight. We'll have our service. We'll reveal our theme and give you the calendar. And then we'll go next door and have some good food to eat and watch the review of the last year and in pictures, okay? And that's always a fun night. So plan to be here next Sunday night for that. All right, and then the workers' dinner is January 7th. If you haven't signed up yet, get your name on that list and be present for that workers' dinner and meeting on Saturday night, January 7th. That's at 5 p.m. All right? All right. Brother Bob, you want to take one of these? And Brother Andy, you want to come get one? Use that one? All right. Who would like to give a testimony tonight? Just say something good about the Lord and give praise to him. They'll bring a microphone to you, and you can do it, all right? Don't. We're not going to wait on you now. There's one right in the back, Jeanette Anderson. All right. Good to see you, Gary. Glad you're back. Good to see you tonight. Okay, Jeanette.
I just want to thank the Lord for saving my wretched soul and for coming as a baby and dying to save my wretched soul. And I'm so blessed for my family and my church family, and so blessed to have an awesome pastor and a pastor's wife. And I can go on and on. I'm so blessed this year.
Amen.
And I wish everybody a Merry Christmas.
Amen. Merry Christmas to you. That's great. Thank you. Tanya.
We're supposed to write out our testimony in RU on Friday nights. And I was just looking back, and we talked about this morning, it says we look back, we can really see how God's hand has moved. And I'm just so thankful for this church and how God's grown me so much in the past, I don't know how long I've been here, about 10 years. And it's such a blessing to see God's hand just weaving through my life and see what he's done. And I praise him for this church and my church family here.
Amen. Amen. It's good. Who's next? Brother Jarvis, from daughter to father.
I just want to say that I'm really thankful to the Lord for the blessing these last several weeks have been, the Christmas time and being able to spend time with my family and grandchildren and even grandchildren in Honduras. And, you know, one of the things that I really wanted to be able to try to explain to the kids in Honduras is wealth, and that I consider myself an extremely rich man. Not financially, but in the things that people want to be rich for,
mm-hmm.
Love and peace and joy and those things that God has given me. And I feel I lived an extremely full life. If God were to take away every single thing I have in my life, I could only tell him thank you for what I have had. It's funny how, I don't know if it's because I'm getting older, people tell me I am, but you tend to, you're looking ahead. I don't think of it as being something to worry about, because God has been so good in the past. I mean, what's the worst that could happen? I mean, die, glory to God. That's the whole reason we went through life, is for that. But I look forward to what's coming. I don't know what that is right now. I don't know how things are going to go. I know my plan is got tickets to go to Honduras, and I'm looking forward to that. I'm praying that'll be an exciting time, God willing. But I just want to thank all of you. I really, really enjoyed. Glad we moved here. I love the church.
Amen.
We tune into you guys, you know, when we're out on the road too, because I know I can always get a good sermon. So,
praise the Lord.
I want to thank you all for that.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Jarvis. Amen. We're glad you're here. All right. Right up here in the front, Xavier.
A couple quick things. I mentioned it to Pastor yesterday, but I was at work on Thursday just sitting at my desk doing something, and I hear out in the lab right behind me somebody quoting scripture, and I thought, what in the world? So I looked, and it was a guy from our testing department, and he was in there talking to my engineers and witnessing to him a little bit, and I thought to myself, I didn't know that guy was a Christian. I haven't been there that long, but I emailed him as he was doing it, and I figured he'd check his email later. I said, brother, I was praying for you. What in the world? So I said, let's talk sometime, and he said, great, thanks for praying for me. He emailed me back finally. So I was just excited, very glad for that. It reminded me, don't start thinking too much like Elijah. So.
Yeah, that's good. There's others out there, aren't there? Amen. That's good.
I have a personal blessing. My family has been pretty stable since my dad got out of the hospital. And because of that, all my siblings got to spend Thanksgiving together. Even Sarah, who was missing for a year and a half. And even Christmas. They're all getting together for Christmas.
Amen.
And I really count that to prayer and the mercy of God. I was even over them over there. So I'm just trying to stay as positive as possible in the situation and just continue to pray for my family that God will continue to show and lavish his grace and mercy on them like he has this past year.
Amen. That's good, Felicia. All right. I think Leland had his hand up back here. Somebody over here, Bill? Do you have somebody? Terry Yoder. Okay. Go ahead, Leland. Then Terry.
Hello. I want to just give thanks to God because he's been extremely a blessing to me, and I'm thankful for the time that we had to go out and share the gospel with the people around the neighborhood and for people to make a decision for God. And I'm just grateful to God because he's mighty powerful. He's real, and he's a blessing in more ways than one. So I just want to give thanks to God because he's showing me that it's not about the things you have, but about what you can do for him. And I'm grateful today that I'm able to do something to show his appreciation or to show him appreciation for Amen. All that he's blessed me with in this church. I thank God for this church because it has led me in the right direction, and it's been a great inspiration to me, an opportunity to give back to what God has given to me, and he's blessed me beyond my wildest imagination, more than abundantly. And I'm grateful and thankful. Thank
Amen.
You for this church.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Leland. That's good. Terry Yoder.
I would like to thank the Lord for allowing my husband and I to come here. It's been a little over a year, and we've been able to transition from a ministry that we had to being missionaries, and has increased our health and given us ability to be able to serve him with new vigor. And I thank the Lord for the converts that we have that are here, the fruit that remains, how that God can change lives and touch people's hearts. And I thank him for the friends that I have here. We have so many friends and people that love us and support us. And I thank you, Pastor, for the wonderful messages that you've given us to encourage our hearts and to lead us closer to the Lord. And Amen. It's just been a wonderful year to be here at Bible
Praise
Baptist.
The Lord. That's great. Thank you, Terry. Amen. That's good. Anyone else? I don't know. Yeah, Sandy.
As you probably all know by now, I was in a terrible automobile accident about 2 years ago, and I was clear on the east side of Columbus, and the Lord put me on this side of Columbus, and I wasn't here a week before I found this church. And I want to say what a blessing God is to put on this church. You're just wonderful, loving people, Amen. And I feel so much at home in this place, and I feel like I found my home.
Amen.
Thank you so much
Amen.
For everything.
Praise the Lord, Sandy. That's great. All right. Does that do it? Andy and Alan? All right. Go ahead, Alan.
All right. I only got to spend a couple months of this year at this church, but y'all made me feel so welcome, and I was so blessed to be able to be a part of the RU family when I was incarcerated, and I really appreciate all the love that the church family has shown to me, and I look forward to spending next year and getting closer to the Lord and getting closer to my family here, and just, I guess, being a better person next year.
Yeah, amen. That's good, Alan. Glad you're here. Okay, back here, Andy.
I just want to testify to the Lord tonight and just give him glory for just the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that he came down, and what that means to me as an individual. The gospel, of course, it saved me from my future and eternity in hell, but it does so much more. I mean, that's just the beginning of the gospel and the Christian life, and having it shine through in your Christian life to when you are struggling, to have that motivate you to keep going. The difference between the lost and the saved person is they don't have that gospel message, that hope of Jesus Christ. Whereas when we are having tough times and we're prone to sin or prone to get discouraged, we have Jesus Christ to lean on and say, okay, you know what? The gospel that saved me can bring me through this. And I just praise the Lord as I realize more and more of what the gospel message is, how much I need it every day, how much I need to remind myself of it every day. And I just thank God for the gospel of Jesus
Amen.
Christ.
That's good. Amen. You want a P.S. from Leland?
I just want to say that I'm thankful that God, long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. I'm thankful to God for that, and that he called me out of the world into his marvelous light. Thank
Amen.
God for that master
Amen.
Plan.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Leland. That's good. All right. Does that do it? Everybody get out what you want to do. Lindy, right behind you there, Mr. McKeon.
I just want to thank God for my salvation and for us moving here 3 years ago. This is my third Christmas
wow.
with you guys. So, I'm so blessed that Bill was able to find a church family for us before we came up here, because that was my biggest thing, and all the friends that I've made. And even though I miss my Florida family, you guys have welcomed me, and I have tons of friends, and I miss them, and it's hard.
Mm-hmm.
But I appreciate you, Pastor, preaching the word, and Brother Bob and Tanya and Kathy, and all your dedication to the church.
Amen. Thank you, Lindy. It's good to still haven't got you a white Christmas up here yet, have we? I know. And we're not real heartbroken about it, but just to be honest with you. But I know you are, but we're okay with that. All right, Pete Abrams.
I'd like to thank the Lord for my salvation, and just want to not miss the point that the good news of the gospel is going out, and it's going out, and it's marching forward daily. But I think what a lot of times we lose sight of is we're not bound here. We're not going to be staying here. He's coming again for
Amen.
Us. And the good news is we're going to have everlasting life, and no more pain and no more tears. He's going to wipe all that away. And what a wonderful place this is going to be for 1,000 years. We're going to follow mm-hmm. him here on the earth, and it'll be wonderful. It'll be just like his name, the ultimate counselor.
Mm-hmm.
So look forward to those times, and we should be glad as Christians, and we should help that gospel go forward as whenever we can. And the words of our testimony are sometimes more than any written page or anything that can be given out. So I want to thank the Lord for his blessings, and he's blessed me so greatly, and such an honor to serve here at Bible Baptist Church. Just wonderful people, and a wonderful family to be a part of. And I want to thank you
Amen.
For greeting me every time you come in. It's just an awesome thing to see the people of God and what he's done in people's lives. I know I'm not what I used to be, goodness knows, I was a terrible, dirty sailor, and I had to mouth the match. I smoked like a train, and I was just as ugly, dirty drunk. But he took me up, and I tell you what, he polished me off. I was broken, but now I'm found, and I'm repaired. And there's people here in the church that'll attest to you. I was a basket case when I came here, but he's lifted me up, and I'm looking forward to that day. We're all going to spring around, and the dead's going to rise first, and we're going to follow him and meet him in the air, and it's going to be a wonderful day.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
That's right. Thank you, Pete. Amen. All right. That do it. Susan?
You know, I'm just thankful that, you know, God brought a good, godly man into my life that I can turn to if I have questions about the Bible. You know, this is my first Christmas with you guys. It'll be a year that I've been coming to Bible Baptist Church next month, actually. And I just thank God for all of you. You guys are my family here. I don't have any other family but you guys and my husband. So I thank God for that. I really do.
Amen. Thank you, Susan. That's good. All right. Okay, thank you, fellas. Appreciate you helping out. And Brett and Lisa are still packing and getting stuff loaded. I think you're going to a storage unit. Is that what you're doing right now? Until you get a green light on a place to go to. And Brett goes back to work, I think, Tuesday. But they'll be after 1 p.m. Is that right? Or whenever? Okay. You would see him anytime this week. If you have any time available, just help. What are you doing? Packing boxes and such? And put them in the truck. Okay. If anybody has any time and you can help the Linkies this week, I know they'd greatly appreciate it and would really be a blessing to him, especially as he starts back to work. And let him know, would you? Him or Lisa, get with him tonight. And I know they'd appreciate any help they can get. All right? All right, let's take a songbook. Let's sing again together, shall we? Turn over to, let's do 144, Silent Night, Holy Night, All is Calm, All is Bright. Something nice about singing that on Christmas night, isn't it? And 144, let's stand together to sing, shall we? All of us standing, 144. Brother Bob?
Silent Night, Holy Night, make somebody feel welcome. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together.
Thank you.
Let's sing that third together as you find your seat. Silent night, holy night, Son of God loves pure light. Silent night, holy night, Son of God loves pure light. Radiant beam from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Let's sing that last all together without the instruments on that last. Silent night, holy night, wondrous star, blend my light with the angels, let us sing.
Singing. Go ahead and be seated if you will. And I did mention earlier, Jan's brother, Barry, is that right? Bruce is here from Georgia and drove today just to get into church tonight. How about that? And I don't know about that part of it, but I know he drove today. And I'm glad you came tonight, Bruce. It's nice to meet you. Good to have you in the service tonight. All right. That's great. And how long are you going to stay up here? No, north. About 4 days, good. Well, enjoy your time with your sister and your family. That's great. All right, let's ask the Lord's blessing on our offering tonight. Brother Lindemann, I'd like you to pray for us, if you would, please.
Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you again, Lord, for loving us the way you do, taking care of us, Lord. None of us would be saved tonight, Lord, if it wasn't for you coming here to die for us and to take our place. We just want to thank you for that tonight, Father. And again, Lord, we just ask you to bless the offering now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
I enjoyed that, didn't you? Great job, ladies. Appreciate you doing that for us. Take your Bible tonight for our scripture reading to Luke chapter 2, please. Luke chapter 2. We are going to read verses 36 through 40. Verses 36 through 40. Luke chapter 2, we read 36 together. I'll read 37 together on 38, alternating, and we'll end together on verse 40 of Luke chapter 2. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please. Let's begin together on verse 36 of Luke chapter 2. Ready? And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she, coming in that instant, gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own city, Nazareth. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, we ask you to add your blessing upon the reading of our scripture now tonight. Lord, we thank you again for the word of God, and thank you so much, Lord, for providing us with the scripture. And Lord, I pray that you'll open our understanding tonight, that we'll receive from it that which you would have for us tonight. Lord, thank you for the good testimonies this evening. Thank you for the wonderful music. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord this evening. Thank you for each one that's come, and Lord, I pray your blessing on the special now. And Lord, tune our hearts to be ready to receive the word of God. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, for hear the angel voice. To love one another, his law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His power and glory proclaim His power and glory evermore proclaim.
Now, Father, we bow before You in prayer as we come to opening up Your word, Lord, and bringing the truth that You have for us tonight. And Father, I pray You'd help each of us to concentrate and give You our attention for the next few minutes, Lord. And I know that some have other activities that are planned for after our service tonight and get-togethers and maybe even things planned for tomorrow. But Lord, I pray that You would help us to give You these next few minutes that we have together as we look into Your word. And may each of us pause for a moment and ask the Holy Spirit to speak to our heart, that we'll not miss what You have for us this evening. And so, Lord, help us and give us what we need. And Spirit of God, do in each one of our hearts what only You can do as the Word of God goes forth. And I'll thank You for it. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we get to the evening of Christmas and sometimes the nighttime of Christmas, and I don't know if you've ever sat wherever your tree is in your house and just looked at it on a Christmas night after everything's over. What used to be presents under there are gone, and it just, the kids are in bed or everything is quiet, and there's a natural letdown that people feel when Christmas Day is over and all the activities are done. One fella said, there ain't nothing as over as Christmas. And he was pretty discouraged. And but the truth is, what I want to help you with tonight is, the Christmas, when Christmas Day's over, that should not be the ending point. That should be the starting point. And you got to go, it can be a new beginning. In fact, I recall so clearly listening to Dr. Hiles talk about Dr. John Rice. He remembers they were getting ready to, they were with Dr. Rice, and they were taking his daughter to the airport, I think, to fly back to college. And he wouldn't see her again for 4 or 5 months. And he said goodbye to her, kissed goodbye, put her on the plane, and he walked away and got in the car, and he got out something and started working on it. Dr. Hiles looked at him and says, how do you do that? He said, I'd say goodbye to my kids, and I go and I find a quiet place, and I cry my eyes out for a while. I'm not going to see them. And Dr. Rice taught, he said, he taught me something that day. He said, I always, when there's an end to something, I always start a new beginning to something else. So I always, I'm looking forward to something else starting when something else is ending. And I never forgot that point, and I want you to see that as we look in Luke chapter 2. Jesus' parents take him to the temple, and he's 40 days old now, and they're going to present him to the Lord, as is the custom of the law. And so while they're there, of course, you know, the first person they meet is the man Simeon, whom the Lord had told him he wouldn't die until he saw the salvation of Israel, until he saw the Messiah. And so Simeon's there, and right after Simeon, they meet the person we read about tonight in verses 36 through 40. And I want to look at Anna, and we're going to draw some principles that will help us to say, now that Christmas is over, now what? We'll draw some principles from that, all right? Number one, I want you to notice here in verse number 36 and 37, Anna said was a prophetess. She was the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher, and she was a great age and lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. She was a widow of about 84 years. And there's the way it's worded here, it's hard to tell. We know that she was only married 7 years, and now she's been a widow. She could be a widow of 84 years of age. She could have been a widow for 84 years. In other words, she could be 84 or she could be in her early hundreds, depending on how you want to take that. But anyway, she's of a great age. Okay, now Joe the Jacket didn't say she was 70, so you're not of a great age yet, amen. And you know that, but she was way beyond that, and she's very aged here. But Anna's teaching us something, and here's the first lesson we learned from Anna: Stay as close to the Lord in every situation. Stay close to the Lord in every situation. Here's Anna, only married 7 years. Now, most of us know they married young in those days. Would not be unusual for a girl 16 years old to get married in Bible days. And Mary was only a teenage girl when the angel appeared to her. And so would not be unusual. Only 7 years of marriage and her husband dies. So undoubtedly, he died in his 20s. Now, the Bible doesn't say what happened to him. Doesn't say if robbers got him. Doesn't say if he got sick with an illness and died. Doesn't say if there was some terrible accident. Doesn't say if he was killed by a Roman soldier. There's no details given. It's just that she suffered a tremendous heartache in her life by losing her husband after only being married 7 years. And listen, those are times that people, when they have great heartaches like that, or they have great tragedy like that, it's a time when many can turn away from God. And many turn their back on the Lord. And Anna didn't do that. She went closer to God because of what she went through. And no matter what the situation is, you have to determine that I'm going to draw closer to the Lord. She didn't depart from the temple. Notice what it says. She was a widow of 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers. How often? Night and day. She was always there. She didn't take a vacation. Doesn't say she did. She didn't take any days off. Doesn't say that she did. She was just always there. She would take in every opportunity to be as close to God as she wanted. Listen, where are the Christians who don't want to say, well, I can still do this and be saved. Come on, I can still do this and I'm still a Christian. I mean, I can do this and I'm not going to hell. Listen, where are the Christians who are not saying, I don't want to see how far away from God I can get and still get in and still slide in the door. I want to see how close I can be to God in every situation. That's what Anna was. How close can I get to God in every situation, including times of sorrow? One of the best-known Christmas hymns is I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. And it was written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And he wrote the words late in the Civil War. And some of the story behind that song is very interesting. In July of 1861, his wife, Fanny, had trimmed some of their 7-year-old daughter's curls. And she decided to preserve the curls in a sealing wax. But as she melted the wax, a sudden breeze came through the window and blew her dress into the flame. And her light dress immediately was engulfed in fire. Wanting to protect her two daughters in the same room with her, she ran across the hall into her husband's study where he was working. He immediately tried to smother the flames with a throw rug, but when that didn't work, he just tried to smother the flames by hugging her. And he incurred severe burns to his face and to his arms and hands. In fact, he was so severely burned that he was in the hospital still and didn't even get to attend his wife's funeral. In 1862, the Civil War escalated, and the death toll began to mount. And in his diary for that year, Longfellow wrote this: "The children say a Merry Christmas, but that is no more for me." In 1863, Longfellow's son ran away to join the Union Army, and he was severely wounded and returned home in December. And there is no entry at all for Christmas in his diary for that year. For Christmas Day the following year, Longfellow wanted to pull out of his despair, and he tried to capture the joy of Christmas once again. And so he wrote the words, "I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. And wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men." But when he came to what was the sixth stanza of the song, he was stopped by the thought of the condition of his country. The Battle of Gettysburg had not been long past. The days looked dark, and he probably asked himself the question, how can I write about peace on earth and goodwill to men in our war-torn country? Brother fights against brother and father against son. But he kept writing, and you know what he wrote? "And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth," I said. for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. We might think those words fit pretty well in our day too. But as he stayed with it, and he didn't endeavor to get away from God, but strove to be closer to God, he got an eternal perspective on the matter. And the real message of Christ came through to him. And he ended by saying, "Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to man." Called staying close to the Lord in every situation. And the truth is, we can draw as close. Listen, you can draw as close to the Lord as you want to be. How close are you to the Lord Jesus tonight? I'll answer that for you. You're as close as you want to be. You're as close as you want to be. We have a great opportunity to be as with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of God, with the ability to come boldly to the throne of grace. With the invitation to draw nigh to me, and I'll draw nigh to you. We have a tremendous ability to be as close to God, as close to the Lord Jesus, as we want to be. And sometimes on earth, in earthly relationships, we're not real close to someone because they don't desire to be close to us. That's never the case with the Lord. If there's ever a problem of us being distant, I just feel like he's distant from me. God hasn't moved. We've moved. And so we can be as close to God as we desire to be. And stay close to the Lord in every situation. That's the first lesson we learn here from Anna. The second one is this. The second one is serve the Lord every way you can. Serve the Lord every way you can. She did it by not departing from the temple, by serving God with fastings and prayers night and day. We have no way to know exactly. And by the way, if she was there for 80 years, you know, we have no way to measure the blessing she was to the people at the temple. Because we don't know all that she did there. But she kept herself busy serving in anything she could do. Did she try to keep rooms clean? Did she try to straighten things up? Did she bring things to the priest? I'm sure she did anything she could do. But she was just going to serve the Lord any way she could. She's going to serve the Lord every and any way that she could. We know she had prayers. We know she fasted and prayed. And I'm sure that we know that she had a close relationship with the Lord. And she served the Lord every way she could. And by the way, she served the Lord not only every way she could, but as long as she could. As long as she could. She could have been 105 years old. And I don't know, people probably looked at her and thought, man, when is she going to retire? Huh? And she wasn't in her vocabulary. She says, I'm going to serve God till he takes me home. I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to serve God any way I can for as long as I can. And I'm sure she didn't do things at 105 she did when she was 35 or 45. But she found something to do for God. And listen, there's always something to do for God. There's always ways to serve the Lord. And by the way, if you just serve the Lord with prayers and fastings, that would be a tremendous blessing. If you say, well, I can't get out like I used to get out, and I can't go like I used to go. Oh, but you can pray as good as you ever have. And I hope you can pray better than what you ever had. And you can fast and pray, and you can take the needs on the prayer list, and you can hear prayer requests that are mentioned, and you can say, man, I'm going to go to God on behalf of these people. And I'm gonna make it a ministry of prayer. And I can do that no matter what age I am. But time is short, folks. We have to serve the Lord while we can. Time goes by so quickly. I know that seems strange to kids. And it seemed strange to me when I was a kid. But it's not strange anymore. And things go by. Time just goes by quickly. So you have to decide, I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm going to be faithful to serve God any way I can. What needs to be done? How can I help? Look for ways and look for opportunities to serve and say, I want to get plugged in. I want to do something for God. Hey, that's what you do when something ends, when Christmas is over. Now what do I do? Well, I want to stay as close to the Lord as I can. I want to serve God any way I can. And I want to serve God for as long as I can. All right? Let's go number three. Number three is trust God to supply you with joy. Trust God to supply you with joy. We have no idea of knowing what kind of day Anna was having when Joseph and Mary showed up. I know this. I know that if she was 84 or if she was 104, I'll guarantee you something hurt that day when she was walking around doing what she wanted to do in the temple. Because I'm not 84, nor am I 104, but something hurts every day. Anybody, do I have a witness? Huh? You know, just the way it is, and goes with the territory. And so I don't know what was hurting, if a knee was hurting or bones were aching or arthritis was acting up or whatever it might be. But she was just going about her duties, doing what she should have done. Hey, she might even have felt kind of lonely. She's by herself. She's been by herself for 84 years. And just give herself to serving God. And by the way, that was a lonely thing for her. Especially when she would see young couples coming in all the time to dedicate their children to God, present them to the Lord. I wonder if her mind ever thought back to those years ago when she was married. God didn't see fit to give her children, and God saw fit to take her husband, and she just continued to serve the Lord. She might have had some heavy burdens. She might have had some physical ailments. She had no idea what she was about to see. She was about to see the Christ child. It was going to change her day right there. Notice, she coming in that instant. Now, she came in that instant after Simeon made his declaration. She came in that instant and gave thanks likewise unto the Lord and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. Oh, she got excited. She just going about her normal day and she, listen, her normal routine, her normal what she always did every day, and she ran into the Savior. She saw Jesus, and that changed everything. And now she's happy, and now she's got a burst of joy in her that she wasn't expecting to have. But listen, when you draw as close to the Lord as you can, and you serve Him as long as you can, and any way you can, God's going to give you joy that you never expected. God will give you joy that you weren't looking for, but you ought to be expecting. And it comes in the normal things that you do in serving God. She heard Simeon say, Lord, let your servant depart in peace, for mine eyes have seen your salvation. And then she received great joy. Many times the Lord will do the same for us. Little things will come. I tell you, two weeks ago, down at the prison on Thursday night, Brother Allen, to listen to those guys. The one fellow who just got saved the week before tell me that I read the Gospel of John all the way through this week. He said, and I read Proverbs every day this week. He said, I never did read the Bible, but now I can't put it down. Huh? Oh, I tell you what, you know what that is? Yeah, that gives you a burst of joy right there. Say, hallelujah. That I think you got something there, fella. And the other fellow saying, man, he says, another guy got saved 3 weeks ago. He says, man, I feel like I'm on a ride and the wind's blowing my hair back. And I'm like, whoa. Huh? That's how he described his salvation. Huh? And, you know, listen, let that, God gives you things like that along the way. And, boy, you know what that does? That just says, man, let's go. Let's keep going. That's great joy. That's great joy. There's times when God allows us to see his hand at work. Don't take that for granted. Let that joy come to your heart, and he gives us a special touch. One lady talked about the night she went into her daughter's room to pray. She said, my daughter was 8 years old at the time, and during her prayer at bedtime, right out of the blue, she'd never prayed this before, she said, Jesus, please lock all the doors if they haven't been locked. And her mother kind of chuckled to herself, as, you know, kids come up with things, and didn't quite know where that came from, but she didn't think anything about it until the next morning when she opened the door to get the newspaper. And when she opened the door, guess what was on the other side of the door? Her keys that she had left in the lock from the night before. And she had to smile how God had her daughter pray, Jesus, lock all the doors. You see, those are just little moments that you say, okay, God, thank you. You see, Those are the things that God lets you know that he's watching out for you and he's protecting you. God wants to give you joy. I think the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. See? God says we ought to serve him with joy. Serve the Lord with gladness. And so it's important. Nehemiah said this way, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Strength. Hey, what the joy that it brings to God, that strengthens me. Not necessarily just God giving me joy, but I want to bring joy to his heart. And if I know that it brings joy to God's heart, that'll strengthen me to keep doing what I need to do. Do you have joy? When Anna got joy, you know what she did? She couldn't keep it to herself. She had to share it with everybody. You notice what it says? She spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. She went around telling everybody. When you get the joy of the Lord and he fills your cup, it spills over. And you got to tell somebody else about it. And you got to let that joy come out. People, you can't help but share it. Stay close to the Lord. Serve the Lord. Expect the Lord to supply you with his joy. Trust him to do that. And then number four is purpose to grow spiritually. Purpose to grow spiritually. And I use that word on purpose, all right? Verse 40. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now that's speaking of the Lord Jesus, of course. Now he's our model. And so if he grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him, then we ought to be desiring to grow spiritually as well. God never wants you to be in a spiritual rut. Okay? A rut is a grave with the ends kicked out. Okay? You're going to die that way. Don't get in a spiritual rut. God says as long as you're in the world, you ought to be growing spiritually. You ought to be growing up as a Christian. In Ephesians 4, it says that we're not to be no more children tossed to and fro, but we're to grow up in him. You know, how many times I listen to Christians sometimes, and two words come to mind as I listen. And the two words are, grow up. Grow up. I don't mean physically. I mean spiritually. Grow up. Just because you've been in church for 20 years doesn't mean you've grown. There are a lot of people who are older, but they've never grown up. I'm talking spiritually. And they've not grown up the way the Lord desires them to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Only you're going to answer this question. Are somebody who is close enough to you that you'll let them tell you the truth? And you ought to ask them or ask yourself, am I growing spiritually? We had our RU people on Friday night write out their testimony, not necessarily of salvation, but write out their testimony of since you've been attending Reformers Unanimous, what has God done in your life? What changes has God used Reformers Unanimous to bring about into your life? Say, if you've been here 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, you say, well, I don't think anything happening. Well, then you need to step back and say, what am I here for? And by the way, I think same thing's true with you're coming to church for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, and 6 years, 10 years, and you say, I don't see anything happening. Then you have to ask yourself, what am I coming to church for? It is designed to help me grow, and I'll say more about that in just a minute. Let me ask you a question. If you're not sure if you're growing or not, here's some questions to ask yourself. Do I stay away from painful experiences? Or do I welcome them with the knowledge that they may help me to grow? Am I sure of God and his resources? That I'm free of a spirit of demanding things from God? Or being overly concerned about how my needs will be met? You say, oh, preacher, I don't worry, I just get concerned. And you call a horse, not a horse, but it's still a horse. And so don't just change the word around and say, well, I don't worry, I just get overly concerned. You know, no, you're worrying. And do you trust God and his resources? Is it your goal to be happy, or is it your goal to be holy? Am I more consumed with getting pleasure from God or giving pleasure to God? Do I have a compassion and a concern for others? Am I a reconciler? Am I a peacemaker? Do I seek to get others to be reconciled to God? Am I endeavoring to get others to be at peace with God through Jesus Christ? And am I always trying to make sure that I can reconcile others to each other? Or am I trying to fan the flames? Yeah, I can't believe they'd say that about you. Which do we do? Remember, I'm not saying you may see all of these happening all at one time and have the right spirit all at one time, because we are growing in grace. So you may, sometimes when you grow, you go forward a little bit and then you may go backward a little bit. But overall, you're getting forward. Three steps forward, maybe one step backward. But keep going forward and keep growing. But now listen, spiritual growth, here's the difference between physical growth and spiritual growth. There, physical growth, all you really don't have to do a whole lot. For these little kids to grow, all they do is eat and then play. And in sleep. And they grow. They don't really put any thought into it. And then they don't try to get any bigger. And some of us, as we get older, we're not trying to get any bigger either, but it just keeps coming, you know? Brother Bowman, don't you say a word, all right? These beanpole guys, you know, they think they're... You probably eat everything you want, don't you? Yeah, I know you don't. Oh, okay, all right. Here's the difference. Spiritual growth doesn't just happen. Spiritual growth is not automatic with the passing of time. Millions of Christians grow older without ever growing up, without ever maturing spiritually. Spiritual growth is intentional. Spiritual growth is intentional. It requires a commitment to grow. You have to make a decision that you're going to grow. And you're going to make an effort to grow. Listen, salvation begins with a decision. I will trust Jesus Christ as my Savior. That is a decision you make. But discipleship and following Jesus Christ and growing in grace is also a decision you make. You say, I am going to make the effort. I'm going to put the commitment. And Friday nights with RU, we always tell the people when they come in, say, I didn't do any challenges this week. What do I tell them, Quentin? You either make an effort or you make an excuse. Say, what's it going to be with you? I do that to prison with guys as well. Get right up and say, you know, we have a saying in RU. When nobody does any challenges, you're either going to make excuses or you're going to make an effort. What's it going to be with you? I always make sure the guard's behind me when I say it. No, I don't. But, I say, and you know what? They always say, I'll make the effort. I say, that's the right answer. You have to make the effort. And you do. That's not just for RU. That's for Christianity. You have to make the effort. You have to make the commitment. Don't let your spiritual life get stuck in a rut. I'm just going to give you two requirements for spiritual growth here. And number one, of course, is you have to feed on the Word of God. You have to feed on the Word of God. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word that you may grow thereby. You know why? You know why? It's real simple why some people don't grow. You know why it is? You neglect the Bible. You don't read it. Now, that takes a commitment. It takes effort to get up in the morning and get a quiet place, open the Bible up, and read it. And there are mornings you're not going to feel like doing it. Your flesh is going to say, I don't want to. And you have to tell your flesh, you're not running my life. I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do. And you get up and you sit down and you read God's Word. Effort, commitment, that I'm going to do what's necessary to grow. And I can't grow without the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And so you can't, that's why when you come to church, what are you coming to church for? You're coming to church to hear the Word of God. I'm going to give you the Word of God. Why? I want you to grow. I want you to grow spiritually. And what I say isn't going to have you grow spiritually, but what God's Word is going to help you grow spiritually. That's why every time you come, we open up the Bible. But you don't just need it on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night. You need it on Monday and Tuesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. You need it every day of the week. So you have to get a relationship with God's Word. One pastor said, an unread Bible is like food that is uneaten, a love letter that's never been read, a buried sword, a roadmap unstudied, and a goal and some gold that's never been mined. That's your Bible if you leave it unread and unopened. Let me give you the second thing you need to grow. You have to feed yourself on the fellowship of other people, the fellowship of other believers. The truth is, God set it up that we need relationships to grow. That's why he said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is. But so much the more, but he said, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Exhorting one another is encouraging one another. You know what? You don't grow like you ought to grow isolated from other believers. Doesn't work. God didn't set it up that way. God set up that you would gather together. God set up that you would be a family of believers. God said he sets the solitary in families. Now, that's not necessarily physical families. Some of you testified tonight how this has become your family. And that's right. We sing, I'm glad I'm part of the family of God. And this is our church family. And that's the way it should be. You know what that does? That helps you grow. It gives you accountability. And accountability is a good thing. I mean, years ago I heard Paul Harvey tell the story about a 73-year-old man rescued by his friends just in the nick of time. The farmer had been pinned under his tractor for 3 days and three nights. He suffered through a terrible storm. He had to have his leg amputated below the knee. But it could have been a lot worse because it could have cost him his life. And it would have, too, if his friends hadn't come looking for him. Why did they drive out to his farm to check on him? Because he missed Wednesday night church service. He never missed church. He never missed a service. And when he didn't show up on Wednesday night, they knew something must be drastically wrong. And they drove out to his farm and found him. His faithfulness to the house of God saved his life. Or he'd have died. Don't underestimate relationships. Don't place little value on, well, if I'm not there, no big deal. No, it's a big deal. It's a big deal to you, but it's a big deal to somebody else. Because you are an encouragement to somebody else. I know, you think, not me, man, nobody cares what I'm, no. You'd be surprised. The influence. And you need others, and others need you. That's why God told us to meet together. So, it gives us the spiritual growth we need. So one of the great things you can do, now that Christmas is over and you begin to look ahead, you say, all right, one of the things I'm going to do, I'm going to make the commitment to grow spiritually. I'm going to decide I'm going to be in my Bible every day. And I'm going to decide I'm going to be in church every time the doors are open. And I know I'm talking to people who are in church on Christmas Sunday night. I know. You've got a commitment already. Don't lose that. And encourage others to make that commitment. There's nothing, the best discipleship program there's ever been is Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Well, I've seen Christians who, newborn Christians just get saved, and you say, do you go out and meet them for Bible study? I'm not opposed to that if that's what you do, but listen, you know what the best thing you can do for that Christian? Get them back in church Sunday night. Get them back in church Wednesday night. Get them back in church next Sunday. Get them back Sunday night. Get them back Wednesday night. And boy, if they'll make that part of their routine, if they'll just get that settled, I've watched them just take off spiritually. And they grow. Because the atmosphere is right. And they got the right food to grow on. See? And they'll grow. They'll grow. Make that commitment. So what do you do when it's over? It's not the end. Make it a beginning. And the beginning will be, I'm going to stay as close to the Lord as I possibly can in every situation. Especially in hard situations. When I don't understand. I'm going to serve the Lord every way I can. I'm going to serve the Lord every way I can for as long as I can. I'm going to trust God to supply His joy in my life. I'm going to trust Him to give me joy as I serve Jesus. And then I'm going to desire and purpose to grow spiritually in the coming year. I want to look back at Christmas 2017 and say, hey, I've seen some differences in my life since 2016. I've seen God do some things in my life. That's how you can get a new beginning out of something that's ending. All right, let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this evening. Thank you for the attention of everyone tonight. And Lord, thank you for Anna. Lord, thank you for including her in the account here in Luke chapter 2. She's helped us. She didn't know that that's what she was doing, but she's helped us tonight. And Lord, I pray that tonight you'd help each one of us to just quietly be able to say to you, Lord, I want to be as close to you as I possibly can in every situation. I want to serve you in every way I can for as long as I can. Lord, I'm going to trust you to supply me with joy, that folks will see that I serve the Lord with gladness. And the joy of the Lord will be my strength. And Father, I want a purpose to grow spiritually in the coming year. Make us students of the Word of God. Give us a desire, like the baby does for the milk. Give us that desire for the Word of God, that we could grow thereby. And then, Lord, a desire for fellowship with the people of God. Oh, to be around people who love you, want to serve you, and want to please you with their life. That helps us so much. So Lord, help us to set out, to set our sights on a new beginning as this Christmas day comes to a close. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and I'll finish praying in just a moment. Wonder how many folks tonight would say, preacher, the Lord spoke to my heart tonight. Maybe it's just drawing close in any situation. Maybe it's just saying, I'm just going to serve God any way I can for as long as I can. Maybe it's asking God to help you to have the joy of the Lord in your life again. Just start looking for that joy, looking for God to do things, and you say, Lord, I know that's you. Let it bring joy to your heart. Maybe you need to determine that you're going to grow spiritually. You need to purpose that in your heart. You're going to be a student of the Word of God. You're going to deny the flesh. You're going to make sure you get up and spend time with God every day. And you're going to be faithful to the house of God in 2017. Faithful to fellowship with other believers. Just wonder how many folks tonight would say, preacher, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat tonight and He spoke to my heart. Pray for me this evening. Would you slip your hand up, Christian, and say, pray for me? Yes. Amen. Amen. All right, you may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray, and then we'll have our invitation. The Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening, will you? Father, thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for speaking to us through your word tonight. I pray now that your will be done in this invitation. Thank you for hands that have been uplifted, indicating you've spoken to our hearts. Lord, I pray that each of us now would do what you're bidding us to do in our heart. Hear our prayer tonight at this altar, and we'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening, will you?
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly at his feet. I bow, worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Make me, Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine.
I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Father, we thank you now for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for just a wonderful day today. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord with the people of God. Thank you, Lord, for the songs that we've sung today and heard today. Thank you, Lord, for the Word of God. It's helped us today. It's encouraged us today. And Lord, we love you. We thank you so much for being our God and for so loving us that you'd sent your Son. Unto us a Son is given. Lord, thank you for Jesus, and thank you for a great salvation that he's purchased for us. And Lord, we love you tonight. Dismiss us with your care. Watch over us as we go our different ways, and those who may be traveling yet tonight or tomorrow, please watch over them and give them safety. And Lord, I pray that we'd be doers of the word and not hearers only. Help us to please you in all we do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's hear you sing it. Here we go. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.